Good morning. So now we're going to start chapter 21, which is a discussion of mechanical waves. And one note before we start this chapter, that if you look in the workbook on page 107, you will see a page which lists terminology that's used in this chapter and also back in chapter 14. And so you'll be responsible for the definitions in this chapter, so you can keep track of those definitions on this page as we work our way through the chapter. So we're going to start on page 427 in chapter 21. Okay, first off, we need to define what we mean by mechanical waves. There are several definitions shown here on page 427. All right, so in section 21.1, you'll see that a mechanical wave is described as a physical disturbance in an elastic medium. And we just finished chapter 13 on elasticity, so you understand elasticity and what's meant by elastic materials and elastic objects. So a mechanical wave does require a medium, and it requires an elastic medium. The reason we're talking about mechanical waves is a requirement to understand waves before we start talking about sound. Now, there is one more statement about waves, mechanical waves, which is important. In the paragraph at the top of page 427, before we get into the first section 21.1, the last sentence is important as well to understand waves. And that statement says that a mechanical wave involves involves the transfer of energy without the transfer of material. So even though a mechanical wave moves through an elastic medium, we're not actually transferring material from one place to another. We're merely creating a disturbance in that medium. So really what a mechanical wave does is it transfers energy through a medium. And we'll illustrate that with several examples. So those are two statements which are very important about mechanical waves. So next, let's brainstorm a list. What are different types of mechanical waves? We've defined mechanical waves, but what are some examples of mechanical waves? Does anybody have any ideas? Now, remember back in chapter, in December, we started talking through chapter 33, which is the chapter on light. And light was one type of electromechanical wave, electromagnetic wave. So we have electromagnetic waves. And we said that light was one type of electromagnetic wave. Now, an electromagnetic wave, as we discussed back in December, can travel without a medium and does travel without a medium. And it's a combination of electrical and magnetic energy, very unlike a mechanical wave. So we also said that another type of electromagnetic wave was radio and TV signals. We talked about ultraviolet radiation, infrared, and there were others in there as well. Now, what about mechanical waves? What would be some examples of mechanical waves? You're a very quiet group this morning. So I'll throw some up here. Okay, how about an ocean wave? That's a classic one that we're all familiar with. And how about another one would be, of course, you've all attended sporting events, maybe in large stadiums. You ever remember in a stadium either participating in or seeing a wave where people are standing up and sitting down, and there's a wave which is traveling around the stadium? So that's actually is a type of mechanical wave. And in fact, in your workbook, there's a humorous article on page 108 in your workbook. There was actually a university in Hungary where some professors did a study about waves in stadiums. And it's quite humorous, but it is a mechanical wave. As the wave in a stadium is transferring energy around the stadium, and people are jumping up and down, but you're not actually transferring one person from one place in the stadium to another. So that's actually a good type of mechanical wave to understand what we mean by transfer of energy without transfer of the actual medium, in this case, the people. And finally, what we're most interested in is the fact that sound waves are mechanical waves as well. Sound waves do not fit into the category of electromagnetic waves. Okay, so let's move on now to the next section, 21.2, where we'll talk about several different types of mechanical waves. Okay, so section 21.2. So, if I was going to edit the text, I would rename the title of this section to be called The Types of Wave Propagation. And what do we mean by the word propagation? If you look that up in the dictionary, what would that say? Well, propagation would mean how the wave moves. There are several different types of mechanical waves and categorized by how they actually move through a medium. And we'll talk about those two different types in this section. All right, the first type of wave propagation we're going to talk about is called a transverse wave, and that's discussed there in the bottom half of page 427. And there is a definition, and the definition goes like this. The vibration of the medium is parallel, excuse me, hope you're all using pencil. Perpendicular of wave travel, or we'll call it propagation. So the vibration of the medium is perpendicular to the direction of wave propagation. So what does that mean in a physical sense? So there's the example the text gives is at the bottom of page 427, which is an example of a wave moving down a rope. So let's try to sketch that out. So if you have a wave moving down a rope, and let's say the wave is moving in that direction, then what's happening as the wave moves down the rope, that the individual points on the rope are actually vibrating up and down as the wave passes from left to right. So you can see that the vibration of the medium up and down is perpendicular to the direction of the wave travel, which is horizontal. Because remember, in geometry, perpendicular means at a right angle or a 90 degree angle. So let's see if we can illustrate that. All right, so here's a rope. I'm holding on to one end, and the other end is tied off at the door handle. And I'm going to see if I can send a wave down the rope. It might be a little hard for you to see that. Turn this a little bit here. The rope's bouncing around a little bit, but hopefully you can see. Oh, that wasn't a good one. Here we go. So I was sending a wave down the rope, and what you were seeing is each individual particle of the rope was vibrating up and down, but each point, like the one I'm holding here, was not actually traveling from this point down to the door handle and back. Each point of the rope was just vibrating up and down. Let's see if we can do that again. It might be a little hard to see on the camera, but all right, so hopefully you get the idea. So the wave went down to the door handle, hit the door handle, and returned. So really what I was doing was transferring energy, not actually transferring parts of the rope from one location to another. All right, so we just discussed a transverse wave. So what types of waves are transverse waves? So we just illustrated one, a wave in a string or a rope. When we talked about people doing a wave in a stadium, That would be a transverse wave, and also ocean waves. So all of those would be transverse waves. As an ocean wave, the water is going up and down as the wave is traveling horizontally. All right, the next example we're going to type of mechanical wave is called a longitudinal wave. Here's the definition. So the vibration of the medium, in this case, is parallel to the direction of wave propagation. So with a transverse wave, the vibration of the medium was perpendicular to wave propagation. Longitudinal wave, the vibration of the medium is parallel to the direction of wave propagation. So what would be some examples of a longitudinal wave? Well, the classic example, which we're most interested in, is sound. Sound is a longitudinal wave. The example given in the text as an illustration, just to be able to physically see it, is a slinky. And you can see the, we're now on page 428, and all the sketches are trying to show you the coils of the slinky. And a wave would travel through a slinky in a longitudinal manner. So let's try to sketch that out. So here's a slinky showing a wave traveling down the slinky. And what you're going to see is there are some locations where the coils of the slinky are close together, and then there are some places where the coils are spread far apart. Close together, far apart, close together, far apart. And that happens as the wave is traveling down the slinky. And you can see from page 428 that there are a couple of definitions. The area where the coils are tightly packed together and close together is called a condensation. And the areas where the coils are spread apart is called a rarefaction. And the medium is vibrating this way. So the wave is traveling in this direction down the slinky, but the coils themselves are also vibrating back and forth this way. So that matches the definition. The medium, the vibration of the medium is parallel to the direction that the wave is traveling. The coils are not bouncing up and down, they're vibrating this way. So let's try to illustrate this. I have a slinky here, and let's see if we can see that on the video. So let's see if we can illustrate this longitudinal wave. Okay, here's a slinky that's anchored at the far end, and I'm going to hold it down at this end.
I'll see if we can send a longitudinal wave down this leak. It doesn't last very long, but hopefully you can see that the coils are vibrating this way as the wave is traveling. Here we go. Hopefully you could see that. So there are times when the coils are close together and times when they're spread far apart, and that's how the wave is traveling down the slope.
So sound waves travel just like the wave traveling down a slinky. So for instance, as I'm talking to you, you're hearing my voice, and the air molecules, sound travels through air, that's the medium. So the air molecules in front of my mouth are vibrating back and forth, and that energy is transferred to you and hits you in the ear, and that's what you're hearing. So the sound is actually a transfer of energy. The molecules that are in front of my mouth are not traveling all the way to you. And so similarly, when you're doing a medical ultrasound scan, you're sending a longitudinal mechanical wave into the patient. And so you're transferring energy to your target, whatever you're trying to scan, and then the energy is transferred back to you. And since the patient is elastic, then the body tissue is just vibrating back and forth to transfer that wave in and out. Okay, so now we're going to cover this next section, 21.3, on wave speed. And in this section, we're only talking about a single transverse wave in a string. And we'll talk about how you would calculate the speed of that wave. Now, what you're going to see in example problems and end of chapter problems, the author will use a number of different terms. So, string, rope, wire, cable, they're all interchangeable terms, okay, in terms of figuring out the wave speed. So, string, rope, wire, cable, they're just different shapes and sizes and different materials of essentially the same kind of object. And the equation for this is shown in the middle of page 429. So the basic equation is V, which is velocity, which would be the speed of the wave. The capital F is the tension in the string, which is a force. So again, in England, in English it would be pounds, in metric it would be newtons. And what do we mean by that? So here's this rope again. So the question is, how tight is the string being pulled? Is the string slack, or is there a lot of tension in the string? And that will have a great influence on the speed of the wave.
All right, in the denominator, this is called the, this is the Greek letter mu, and that stands for the linear density of the string. In other words, are we talking about a tiny, fine little thread, or are we talking about a big, heavy rope? Because that will greatly influence the wave speed. The wave speed will move a lot faster down a thin string than it will down a big, heavy rope, or a big, heavy metal cable, if you will. Now, we are not going to actually use that form of the equation. Let's put it into a form that's a little easier to use. Now the linear density is the mass divided by length. Remember we talked in chapter 15 about density. Density was mass or weight divided by volume. In this case, linear density means mass per length. So what we're talking about is for a given length of string, what's the mass? And the assumption is that for an object like a string or a rope, it's uniform throughout its whole length. It's uniform from one end to the other. Its nature does not change. So the easiest form of the equation for us is going to be this. Mass, the mass of the string divided by the length is in the denominator. That's the definition of the linear density. Now we can even rearrange this further because you'll notice you're dividing by a fraction, which is a bit cumbersome at times. So instead of dividing by a fraction, let's multiply the numerator by the inverse of the denominator. Let's just use that form of the equation. It means, mathematically, it means the same thing. So the speed of the wave is equal to the tension in the wave times the length divided by the mass. We are only going to do these problems in metric. And because remember we talked about mass in English was slugs, we're not going to work in slugs. So these are all going to be metric problems. Let's illustrate this with the example 21.1 on page 429, just to show you how this equation works. So in this example, you're given that there's a string that has a length of 2 meters, and the string has a mass of 0.3 grams. So this really is like a fine little thread, 2 meters, 0.3 gram. And you're asked to determine the speed of a transverse wave, they call it a pulse, but it's a wave, the speed of a transverse wave in the string if it's under a tension of 20 newtons, that's the force or the F term. All right, so let's put in 20 newtons, and we'll use this form of the equation again, it's just easier, times the 2 meters, and divided by the mass which we were given. So the mass was given to you as 0.3 gram, but you're going to want to convert that into kilograms. These are all base units. So tension is in newtons, and mass is in kilograms, and length is in meters. So convert that to kilograms, 1 kilogram per 1,000 grams. So that's going to be very tiny. Get that right.
I believe so. Okay. So the mass would be 0.0003 kilograms. Now, as we've seen before, when you have units which are named after a person, they're not helpful when you're trying to do a calculation. So we all remember now what the definition of a newton is. Remember, one newton equals 1 kilogram times meter per second squared. So I would not write newtons into your equation. I would write the definition of newtons. So the force is 20 kilogram times meter per second squared times your 2 meters. Now what you'll notice now is that the kilogram units cancel out, and you're left with meter times meter, which is meter squared divided by second squared. And also remember that units act just like numbers. So when you take the square root of meter squared per second squared, what do you get? You get meter per second. So make sure you can do this calculation, and in fact, pull your calculators out, make sure you can get the correct answer. The answer in the text is correct. This ends up being 365 meters per second. And that is very fast. That's over 1,000 feet per second. Okay. All right, so to practice this, you can take a look at your schedule. And your schedule has practice problems. End of chapter problems 5, 7, 8, and 9, which is practicing the calculation of wave speed, but also it's practice in, as with all equations we've used, you could be asked to solve for wave speed, or you could be given wave speed and asked to solve for one of the other variables in the equation. All right, we'll talk about those practice problems tomorrow and then go on to the next section, 21.4.